Hello everyone, this is the last video of a playlist about the preparation of carboxylic acids. In this video I'll show you some examples of the hydrolysis of esters, amides, nitriles and trihalides to carboxylic acids. I've also included examples of the hydration of nitriles to amides and the alcoholysis of nitriles to esters. Hydrolysis are the most common reactions performed and often proceed in high yield. In recent decades, enzymatic hydrolysis reactions have been optimized for lipophilic organic starting materials and enable both highly regioselective and stereoselective transformations. I'll show you some examples in a minute. Carboxylic esters can be hydrolyzed both under alkaline or acidic conditions. In a typical alkaline saponification, a carboxylate salt and the alcohol are formed, which do not react with each other. Thus, alkaline saponifications are irreversible. Such saponifications are particularly easy if the alcohol is strongly acidic and sterically undemanding, and if the acid is electron deficient and thus strongly acidic. Trifluoroacetic esters and amides, for instance, or nitrophenyl or cyanomethyl esters are very sensitive and readily react with nucleophiles. Otherwise, sterically demanding, electron-rich esters are more resistant to hydrolysis. Also, very lipophilic or insoluble esters can be difficult to saponify. Polymeric esters, for instance polyethylene terephthalate, PET, are remarkably resistant to aqueous sodium hydroxide because water cannot reach the ester bonds. If esters are hydrolyzed by acids, each step is reversible and a sufficiently large excess of water will be required to attain a high yield of free carboxylic acid. Esters of tertiary or benzylic alcohols can also be cleaved by acids through carbocation formation. Thermal or catalyzed hydrolysis of acid derivatives can also proceed by intermediate ketene formation. Upon reaction with water, ketenes will yield carboxylic acids. Anhydrides are obtained if less than one equivalent of water is used. Ketenes are not stable and tend to dimerize to beta-lactones or cyclobutadiones if no nucleophile is available. Alkaline saponifications become interesting when the starting ester contains other base-sensitive functional groups. Here, for instance, the methyl ester of a short FMOC-protected peptide had to be saponified without cleaving the FMOC group. This could be achieved with a mixture of sodium hydroxide and calcium chloride in aqueous isopropanol. After acidification, 85% of the target acid was obtained. Although it is often claimed that tertiary alkyl esters are resistant to alkaline saponification, this is not the case. In polar aprotic solvents, the hydroxide anion becomes strongly nucleophilic and capable of cleaving bulky esters and even amides. Here, a tertiary alkyl benzoate was saponified with sodium hydroxide in a mixture of dichloromethane and aqueous methanol, even without much heating. The selective monosaponification of diesters can also be challenging. If the two carboxyl groups are electronically conjugated or separated by only one or two carbon atoms, then a single saponification can often be readily achieved, as in this example. Here the remaining ester in the product was deactivated by the negative charge and by the enhanced electron density of the arene and reacted with hydroxide therefore more slowly than the starting diester. If two alkoxy carbonyl groups are however not conjugated and far apart from each other, then a selective monosaponification will be difficult. In this example, a non-symmetric diester could be monosaponified with an excess of potassium hydroxide in methanol. Although the methoxycarbonyl group ortho to the benzoyl amino group was electronically deactivated, it was saponified faster, probably because of the hydrogen bond to the amide. In the polar aprotic solvent acetonitrile, both ester groups could be saponified without cleavage of the amide. Selective monosaponifications of unsymmetric diesters of slightly different reactivity can sometimes be achieved with dilute solutions of sodium hydroxide in ethanol or methanol at low temperature, or without any alkali hydroxide at all, as in this example. Here, a mixture of triethylamine and lithium bromide in aqueous acetonitrile cleanly saponified a methyl ester in the presence of an isopropyl ester. One alternative to the alkaline saponification of methyl esters is treatment with sodium iodide, for instance in pyridine or other polar aprotic solvents at high temperature. SN2 displacement yields methyl iodide and the carboxylate. In this example, a methyl ester was heated with magnesium iodide and toluene, and methyl iodide was probably the main byproduct. But I suspect that the Lewis acidity of magnesium iodide also contributed to drive forward this reaction. With the more acid-labile tertsbutyl ester, a higher yield of acid resulted after only one day. The byproduct probably was isobutene. Another mild Lewis acid suitable for selective ester cleavage is iodine. Here a tertsbutyl ester could be hydrolyzed selectively in the presence of a benzyl ester. Similarly, zinc bromide can catalyze the selective cleavage of tertsbutyl esters under mild conditions. Here a protected ditertsbutylglutamate was saponified only once, just by stirring with zinc bromide in dichloromethane at room temperature. This here is a diester that would be difficult to monosaponify with sodium hydroxide because both esters are electronically isolated from each other. With the aid of the immobilized lipase Novozyme, however, a high yield of monoester could be obtained. Enzymatic reactions suffer from three main disadvantages. First, the reaction mixture must contain a lot of water for the enzyme to be active, and many organic compounds are insoluble in water. Then, the pH of the reaction mixture must often be carefully monitored and maintained at a certain value, because the activity of enzymes is highly pH dependent. This requires buffers, which make isolation of the final product more difficult and increase the amount of waste. Finally, enzymatic reactions must often be quite dilute, what makes the industrial, large-scale use difficult and expensive. The conditions of this example, however, look reasonable. In this example, an ethyl ester was saponified selectively in the presence of a chemically more reactive, morphine-derived aryl ester, again with the immobilized lipase Novozyme. This here is an example of enzymatic enantioselective monosaponification of a malonate. The reaction mixture had to be buffered and the pH continuously adjusted as the hydrolysis proceeded. Amides are generally more resistant to hydrolysis than esters. Their alkaline hydrolysis is particularly difficult, because amines are difficult to deprotonate and amine anions therefore poor leaving groups. Like the alkaline saponification of esters, however, also this reaction is irreversible. Amides are usually hydrolyzed by aqueous acid, and unlike the acid-mediated hydrolysis of esters, this reaction is also irreversible. One equivalent of acid is consumed, and the final products are the carboxylic acid and an ammonium salt, devoid of any nucleophilic reactivity. Let's check some specific examples. Dimethyl acetamide, a convenient polar aprotic solvent, is quite resistant both to bases and acids, but can be cleaved with an excess of potassium tertsbutoxide and water. Acetamide and acetanilide, however, were not cleaved under these conditions, probably because deprotonation of these amides was faster and yielded anionic intermediates which no longer reacted with hydroxide. Here are two more examples to show you how resistant amides can be toward nucleophiles. Heating these two non-enolizable, sterically demanding amides with 20 equivalents of sodium hydroxide to 190 degrees Celsius for 2 days gave only low yields of the corresponding acids. More nucleophilic than hydroxide is deprotonated hydrogen peroxide. Here, a lipophilic amide was cleaved in high yield by heating to 80 degrees Celsius with just one equivalent of sodium peroxide in water. This strategy seems to be versatile and only very insoluble amides remained unchanged. Poor solubility must have been the main reason for the lack of reactivity of the two benzamides of the second equation. Acidic reaction conditions are usually better suited for the hydrolysis of amides. Particularly reactive are lactams, because the energetically more favorable conformation of acylated primary amines is trans. In a lactam, however, the conformation must be cis, what decreases the activation barrier for attacking nucleophiles. In this example, a lactam containing two amides underwent acid-mediated methanolysis only once. Protection of the amino group and a more vigorous hydrolysis then yielded proline and a protected beta amino acid. Some amides are particularly sensitive towards certain catalysts or enzymes and can sometimes be cleaved under almost neutral conditions. Benzamides, for instance, react with alcohols and 20% of a nickel carbene complex in refluxing toluene to esters, as in the example on this slide. Remarkably, a terzbutyl ester remained unchanged under these conditions. Two amino ethanols acylated at nitrogen are also remarkably sensitive. In the presence of acids, such amides rearrange to 2-aminoethyl esters, which, upon treatment with bases, can often be rearranged again to the original amide. Here, such an amide was hydrolyzed just by refluxing in water for 10 hours. Nitriles are easy to prepare by amoxidation or alkylation of cyanide. In my channel, you can find several videos about the synthesis of nitriles. Because of their ready availability, the hydration and hydrolysis of nitriles is an important transformation. Most nitriles react with aqueous hydroxide to yield first amides. Because the alkaline hydrolysis of amides is slow, nitriles can often be hydrated in excellent yields. More vigorous conditions will, however, yield carboxylates. Nitrile hydration can also be catalyzed by acids, as sketched here. Sometimes these hydrations are highly exothermic and can cause accidents. Acetonitrile, for instance, can decompose violently and cause thermal explosions upon contact with aqueous bases. One would expect that highly concentrated sodium or potassium hydroxide solutions are particularly well suited for the hydrolysis or hydration of nitriles. But this is not always so. In this example, phenyl acetonitrile was hydrolyzed to the acid in a biphasic mixture of toluene and aqueous sodium hydroxide at 100 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. As the sodium hydroxide concentration in water was increased from 10% to 50%, the yield of sodium carboxylate dropped from 82% to 4%. The reason for this was probably the decreasing miscibility of the nitrile with the aqueous phase upon increasing hydroxide concentration. For this same reason, highly lipophilic nitriles can be difficult to hydrate or hydrolyze. This here is a typical synthesis of a nitrile by nucleophilic substitution followed by alkaline hydrolysis to the acid. Despite the high cyanide concentration and the high reactivity of alkyl bromides, the substitution proceeded only slowly. Cyanide is a very small anion, like fluoride, that forms strong bonds to protic solvents, what lowers its nucleophilic reactivity. Despite the lipophilicity of the starting bromide, however, both the substitution and hydrolysis gave a high yield. In this example, a structurally more complex nitrile had to be hydrated selectively. This could be achieved with catalytic amounts of aqueous sodium hydroxide in NMP. One byproduct was the addition product of the amide to a nitrile, but under the optimized conditions shown here, only trace amounts of this dimer were formed. Under acidic conditions, it can be difficult to stop nitrile hydration at the amide stage. Here, for instance, 5% of the acid was formed as byproduct. With an excess of potassium hydroxide in terzamyl alcohol, no carboxylate, but also a decarboxylated product was formed. Both reactions required heating and a relatively long reaction time, probably again because of the high lipophilicity of the starting nitrile. Nitriles can also be converted into esters directly, for example by heating with an alcohol and some strong acid. Here, adiponitrile was converted into diethyl adipate by heating with ethanol and an excess of alkali bisulfate. Cyanohydrines are readily available from aldehydes and hydrogen cyanide and can be hydrolyzed to alpha hydroxy acids. Here, an enantiomerically pure aromatic cyanohydrine was hydrolyzed by refluxing with concentrated hydrochloric acid for 3 hours. no racemization or conversion of the benzylic hydroxy group into chloride occurred, because the benzylic cation was destabilized by the cyano and carbonyl group. Under strongly alkaline conditions and in the presence of oxygen, nitriles may undergo alpha hydroxylation and oxidative C-C bond cleavage, as in this example. Here, a nitrile was stirred with an excess of potassium tert-butoxide and oxygen at room temperature for 2 days. A high yield of a carboxylate lacking one carbon atom resulted. With structurally more elaborate nitriles, many things can go wrong, though. In the second example on this slide, no diphenyl acetic acid, but only a mixture of various oxidation products resulted. One important access to the vitamin nicotinamide is hydration of nicotinonitrile. This reaction can also be accomplished without any acid or base, just by heating with manganese dioxide, as shown here. Industrially, however, this hydration is mostly done enzymatically. Also, a platinum-based catalyst has been reported to mediate nitrile hydration at almost neutral pH. Only 0.5% of this catalyst brought about a complete hydration of a sterically demanding lipophilic nitrile by refluxing an aqueous ethanol for 25 hours. The starting nitrile of this example would eliminate acetate or be saponified by treatment with strong bases. Heating in toluene with 1% of Wilkinson catalyst and 5 equivalents of acetaldehyde oxime, however, gave a high yield of the hydrated nitrile without any ester hydrolysis. It is assumed that this reaction proceeded by rhodium-catalyzed addition of the hydroxy group of the oxime to the nitrile, followed by fragmentation into acetonitrile and the amide. Also, trihalomethanes have the same oxidation stage as carboxylic acids and can be hydrolyzed by aqueous acids or bases. Trihalomethanes can be prepared by radical halogenation of methyl arenes or by addition of trihalomethyl radicals to alkenes. Acid-catalyzed hydrolysis of trichloromethyl groups usually proceed by the mechanism sketched here. Geminal dichloroethylenes are also synthetic equivalents of acids and can also be hydrolyzed. Acyl chlorides can be prepared if only one equivalent of water is used. Benzoyl chloride, for instance, is prepared on a large scale by partial hydrolysis of trichloromethylbenzene. In this example, the hydrolysis of a trichloromethyl alkane succeeded by heating with sulfuric acid for 2 hours. No hydrolysis of the primary chloride occurred. It was also possible to first convert the trichloromethyl group into a dichloroalkene and then prepare a methyl ester directly by heating first with sulfuric acid and water and then with methanol. Alpha trichloromethyl alcohols show a unique reactivity caused by their easy base-induced cyclization to dichlorooxyranes. The starting alcohol of this example, prepared from trichloromethyl anion and acetone, readily reacted with ethanolic sodium ethoxide to an alpha-ethoxy ethyl ester. At low temperature, it has even been possible to prepare alpha-chloro acids, as in this example. This is, of course, a difficult reaction because of the easy displacement of chloride by hydroxide, but many other nucleophiles have been used successfully to prepare alpha-substituted acetic acids and esters from trichloromethyl alkanols. Trifluoromethyl groups are usually quite resistant to hydrolysis. Sometimes, however, trifluoromethyl groups are hydrolyzed under surprisingly mild conditions. For example, when 2-trifluoromethylphenol was heated with diethylamine and sodium hydroxide, a salicylamide resulted. Base-induced elimination of hydrogen fluoride from 2-trifluoromethylphenol is particularly easy, and the final product was formed by a stepwise displacement of all 3 fluorine atoms. So, what can go wrong? I've already shown you some potential side reactions, like the alpha oxidation of nitriles. Other typical side reactions include isomerization, decarboxylation of the product, transesterifications, or the racemization of an enzymerically pure intermediates. Most of these problems can be avoided by lowering the reaction temperature and the concentration of hydroxide or acids, by shortening the reaction time, or by an enzymatic hydrolysis. During the base-induced hydrolysis of sterically demanding amides, occasionally nitriles are formed, as in this example. Thus, the high reaction temperature caused a dehydration instead of an addition of water to the starting amide. As we saw in the hydrolysis of phenylacetonitrile, a high concentration of hydroxide not always promotes hydrolytic reactions. Here are some further references which you can also find in the description of this video. For subscribers, there's a PDF version of this presentation under the Community tab. This was the last video of this playlist about the preparation of carboxylic acids. Hope you found it useful and stay tuned for more videos on practical organic synthesis.